Looks like Brandon had a little more luck than I did. I did.
I tell you what though, it did. That was one of the things I really wanted to talk about, was that it took me hours to get a script that would run all the way through, and I had to make a bunch of compromises, removing model types and things that I wanted to try. So it wasn't exactly a smooth experience.
Honestly, same. Yeah, I was encountering similar things, but it's probably a good idea just to go through one case anyway, since we only have like an hour. So yeah, I'd just be curious to hear more about what you had encountered, and I'm happy to talk about sort of what I was exploring as well. But yeah, we could kind of just focus on what you had done. Excuse me.
Yeah. So do you want to give people another minute, or should we just plunge into it?
I
don't know. I hadn't heard from Isabella or Laura.
Yeah. I know that Isabella will be here. I think she's still on holiday or something like that. Oh, Laura as well. I'm not sure, but I didn't hear anything. I didn't hear anything about her. So I think we can even start.
We can see my crap.
I found out my problem is that I missed a package. So I'm now matching your session info with my session info. And I didn't load like XG Boost as a separate package. So
one of the issues that I observed, I mentioned this previously when we had gone through one of the chapters that I was attempting to lead poorly, but like I hadn't installed XG Boost as a package.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, that's the thing with tidy models.
I can't run this model. I don't have this package. And I'm like, well, why didn't you tell me that before you started? You know?
Yeah.
At least give me the option to like stop and load it or install it and then run it. But it doesn't do that. It just like chunks through everything else and
quick question. Do either of you use RENV?
Sorry, can you say it again, Steven?
It's called RENV or RENV, but what it is.
Environment, right?
Yeah, our environment. So I'm just saying when it comes to like package versions and stuff like that, I found that to be pretty helpful just to kind of give you a stable point so you know that you're using the same packages that were used when the code was written.
All right, I'm going to share my screen. I can make things bigger if that's helpful.
Even as an old guy, I can read all that, so I'm good.
Well, that's the problem. These are just like reading glasses, like really weak ones, but I've started to notice lately that I need them.
Yeah, I'm kind of the same. I have glasses, but I wear them sporadically.
The other night I woke up and my eyes were still tired and I was like, something's not right.
So like today, no glasses, but anyway. Yeah.
if you can make it even bigger, that would be.
All right, let me do it. Hold on.
It might be good just for, you know, other potential viewers. Yeah.
We'll split the screen and blow things up.
Yeah, because then on YouTube.
Good.
Yeah, it's even smaller. So.
Well, I'm going to make it really small for YouTube then. I don't want people to know what's going on with my computer. Anyway, so what I did was 3 weeks ago when I was going to try and do this, I really wanted to just take the original data set, which is the Ames housing data set,
right,
and fit some models to it and do like the whole processing, like all the way from selecting the model, running the final model itself or fitting the final model itself, and then evaluating the metrics across multiple models to be able to say that I made the right decision. And then lastly, to be able to like kind of do some evaluation metrics on the final output model, the selected model. And it was a little bit more challenging than I had expected. A lot of like packages were installed and things like that. Because I don't know if you saw, but in my when I had run it previously for the for our session, I had installed those things and run them previously, and then I installed R4.2.
Oh,
which
okay.
means that I, which means oh, no. that I had to reinstall everything again.
Everything, so, yeah, yeah.
But I didn't realize what I needed to install until I had tried to run the model and fit the model, and so it was like spending a half an hour and then telling me that it didn't have XG boost.
And I mean not to like be Mr. Renv today, but yeah, that's the thing where Renv is nice because if you have code, you can just run a step and it will look at all your code and then it will figure out what packages it needs. So yeah, it's
and what versions as well or no?
That's the thing. Yeah. If you have been using it from the beginning, it will set the version. But if you're just using it, you know, based on some code you have, it'll just get the latest version. So yeah, that's where you might have trouble, but you know.
Yeah.
Is it a bug? Useful. Is it a feature? It's yeah. I don't know. Depends how you look at it. Yeah.
It's one of those things where maybe you upgrade and you didn't, you shouldn't have.
Right. You upgrade and everything breaks.
I've done that before, but usually that's me trying to be too bleeding edge and installing something from GitHub.
Right. You can get burned sometimes. Yeah.
Especially during early DPIR development, there were some sketchy moments.
Yeah, I kind of feel like
Hadley was like, I'm going to change how this works completely. Okay.
Yeah, not to go too far off track, but I kind of feel like that's happening a little bit with tidy models because, yeah, that was an issue I ran into.
Yeah.
I was starting a brand new project and it was trying to get the latest version of everything. But since I don't have a compiler on my system, it started choking and blowing up. So, yeah.
Oh, something to watch out for. You've got a lockdown Windows system, right?
So I'm all locked down. Yeah.
Previously, I was able to install RTools on a previous work computer that was really, really locked down.
Oh, that's good to know.
If you didn't install it in like program files, if you installed
homework after our session. Okay, good.
Yeah, if you installed it like somewhere else, like on root C drive or something like that, I could get around it.
Cool.
But anyway, so back to the topic at hand. So, as Federica pointed out, some of these packages don't need to be loaded quite because they're already preloaded by.
Good to know.
They're already preloaded by tidy models, or they're inherited or brought in when you try and use them. I copied the functions and the calls from previous scripts. And so what I did was I consolidated all those library calls to the top of the sheet. Normally they would be kind of interspersed through the book. That's the way they kind of do it, is they load what they need when they need it. And I just, I like to have everything at the top. So that's why that is.
Oh, same. Yeah. I think that's good practice.
So the basics, again, going back to the very beginning, is that, you know, we take our split and we have a training and we have tests. A little bit, I think it was like chapter 4 or something like that, or 3, we did this V-fold cross validation. I kept the numbers really low, to the V numbers really low. We had, normally it was 10.
Right, so that could take a long time, yeah.
I put it to 3 because I just wanted to keep processing time down. Although I don't know if that actually has any impact on XG boost. Because the way they do things is different, so it may have impacts on like the linear models, but not so much on some of the other things.
Okay.
Let me see. So when we, you know, remember we had that really complicated recipe that had all of these steps in it, and then you can like fit that individual model, and you can look at that individual model. And so this was just like, this is an example of kind of an end-to-end if you just wanted to do a simple linear model. Well, I say simple, but actually this is quite complicated, this recipe.
Yeah.
But that's kind of like, you know, that was like the final linear model that we came up with during the book sessions. But then like just after that, we started to say, well, what if we wanted to compare all these individual steps to kind of, you know, or partial steps to each other? Mm-hmm. And so we had the basic recipe, the interaction, the recipe that included the interaction effects, the non-linear spline fit for latitude and longitude, because
right, yeah, I remember that.
Because we had a hard time taking into account longitude and latitude because, like, distance. Mm-hmm. If you think about neighborhoods in the U.S., like, you can be right next door to a bad neighborhood, and your house could be still worth quite a lot more than theirs. Mm-hmm. And then you create a list to kind of put all those models together. And so you create a workflow set from those lists of models, and the linear model type, which is just defined as a linear reg set engine LM. Mm-hmm. And I think this is cross validation false, so it may not even use the cross validation that I set up.
Oh, okay.
I didn't catch that until just now. But then, no, you know. Fine. Yeah. Much later in the book, we started to say, well, what about all these other model types? Like we've got random forest, neural networks, k-nearest neighbors, obviously XGBoost. There was carpet. Was it called carpet bagging or bagging? So those are the ones that I started.
Yeah, bagging and boosting. Yeah.
I started to have difficulties with some of those models. I also had a really hard time with XGBoost. Because of the type of data, and I posted about that, a few weeks back when I was having trouble. So, like, effectively, what I had to do was create the recipe and the spec according to kind of, I forget where it was. I should have put a link to it, but it was the use this package.
Yeah,
I've never used it before, but
I've never used this. Yeah,
I've never used this, but it's effectively it was just kind of like you said. Well, I want to run an XGBoost model. This is the type of stuff that I have. And it spits out a recipe.
Oh, that's cool.
And it spits out the recipe, the spec, and a workflow.
Oh, that's nice.
And even runs it if you have the code. Now, I didn't want it to run it yet because I don't want to run it independently of the other models. So what I did was I created kind of a workflow. So all of these specs, parameters, recipes, and those sorts of things are then combined into very different. So like if we're not pre-processing the data, like we don't need to for a random forest model. Mm-hmm. We give it kind of the outcome that we're really expecting, and we say go to town on it. But whereas for XGBoost, I had to do one hot encoding for factors and mostly factors. Yeah, factors and non-numeric data. Remember the example we did when we did XGBoost for the first time, kind of in our thing. It was the concrete data.
And concrete data.
I looked at the concrete data, and it's like six columns of numbers.
Right, yeah.
And it's like, well, okay, numeric. No wonder that works so easily. Damn things, didn't have to try. So I created a pre-processing step, which is the recipe with where it converts and does all the one-hot encodings. Mm-hmm. And then I just called it boosting. And then, you know, we had done this as well when we did the neural networks. We had KNN and the neural network. We had to specify parameters. So we have some of those parameters up here. Again, I still don't know why it needs 27 hidden units.
That would be nice to know. That's a good question.
I did a bit of research. And basically, this is this is not it shouldn't be so it's not for any type of set that this should be 27. Okay, in the in its book where is it so I'll show you something. Okay.
You want to share your screen or?
Yeah, maybe later. But now, just I put in the chat. This one is the total number of parameters. Okay. As you can see, it's H, which are the hidden number of parameters, P are the features, and then you do plus one and then plus. So This way you can obtain the number of parameters and you can find this here. Okay, so that's when you establish the number of hidden layers, because this the number of hidden layers will influence the total number of parameters. So the greater is the number of hidden layers, the greater is the number of parameters that you obtain. So this is the book, the Max Kuhn book, okay, Applied Predictive Modeling, page 143. This is a bit from the book. And so it's not said 27, but you can even say 13. So there is an average number of hidden layers that usually are the most suitable ones on average or most of the times, but you can even set your own. But bear in mind that the highest number of hidden layers, the highest number of parameters is. So then things get complicated somehow. So, but this is the only thing I found and I can say. Then I can add just this last thing. This is from the ISLR book. The name, where is it? Why is it doing this thing?
I started the ISLR group and it met on Sundays at like 4 p.m. And I...
That's a tough one to... yeah.
I kept forgetting. Because like, I'm not near a computer around that time usually, and it just didn't pop up and remind me, so.
Yeah, I have just finished the Cohort. Basically, we missed the last session with the lab for multi-testing, and then we finished. But there is a chapter on neural network, which is very interesting. It says lots of things. So this is all the only things I found searching, but I'm sure there's more to say.
Yeah. Well, I was just, you know, if it's upon P is predictors. So the predictors are the columns, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Minus the sales price. So that would be 73 in the Ames data set.
Yeah, quite a lot.
Yeah. Anyway, but just, yeah, so maybe 27 wasn't the right one. But it still took a long time to run anyway.
Yeah, I bet.
The point is though, is that like I tried to put all these together, and so we have like all the workflows.
Yeah, you got a lot going on in there. Yeah.
All the workflows together. So like three different linear models, a random forest, XGBoost, K-nearest neighbors, and a neural network.
Mm-hmm.
With probably the wrong level of hidden units. Mm-hmm. But that's okay. At least it worked.
Good.
So I left the grid control in here in case somebody wanted to actually use a grid. But as we discussed in, I forget which chapter, maybe 10 or 9 or 11.
Yeah.
Race is using a race control is a way to sample that grid and then kind of hone in on an area that's more important.
Right. You don't waste time in a unfruitful area. Yeah.
So I use that, which speeds things up. It runs many, many, many fewer models. Federica had a comment about my use of do parallel, which was maybe underutilized because It only did run on two cores, and I think that it could hypothetically run on all eight of my machine's cores. But I might test that afterwards. Do you have more to say, Federica?
No, just that that's absolutely another world to explore, and very interesting. But I've used just do parallel. And I just have two cores, so but then you can even specify number two in so basically I've run the block, everything with a little modification I sent, and it worked, so I managed to do the graph and everything. Then we see that if they match. But it works for me. If you do parallel and then register parallel, and that's it, nothing else, you just activate the cores and you can do the rest. I don't know what all these things for me, and what are they actually? What do you do with unregistered do parallels? So then do you unregistered parallels?
Oh,
I don't do that.
The unregistered do par? I ran into a bug or an error, and I was trying to fit a model after I had stopped the cluster. And apparently sometimes you can run into this at this Stack Overflow. Somebody had run into it before where like the clusters don't actually get completely stopped. And so the machine thinks it needs to use multiple clusters.
Oh no.
It doesn't anymore, or it thinks it has more than it does. And so this was like a way to remove that completely. So I just put that in there cause I found it useful. But when I run this whole thing, I don't have to have that anymore. So it must have just been something that I was doing at that particular moment. But I found it useful, and I thought I'd leave it in there in case you see that error. Because it took me like 30 minutes to figure out what the hell was going on. And so I thought maybe I'd save you some time. So the next big thing was like, okay, well, I've got race results, so this is what this is all the workflows, pre-processing, this is what it looks like. Post-processing, you don't have to make a copy of it like I did. In fact, it's probably more good. The whole point of this, right, is that you, as you run the models, you fill in these results in this object, so you don't double the objects. I copied the objects in this case because I wanted to be able to share before and after. And so you can see, these are sampled, resampled. These are all using the race outputs. And then what you can do is, because this takes an hour to run, if we were to do tenfold V cross validation and 73 hidden units, those things are going to take a long time to process. And so it's just kind of like, well, I've run it, I don't want to have to rerun it, so save it out. And there were many different ways to do it. This was something I just ended up picking RDS because it seemed to be the simplest, most direct one, was to just save it out. But multiple places, including Julia's blog and some RStudio documents, they used this butcher package to shrink the size of that saved object. So that, because if you have a truly big model fit that takes a long time and you fit to it, the model object has all that data and all of the samples and everything embedded in it, and you don't always need all those things for further like perusal. And so it can create huge objects that are then hard to save and also hard to read back into R. This object I don't think is very big. Where the hell is it? Uh, 30, 32 megabytes, 31 and a half megabytes. So it's, you know, the object from this thing is only 32 megabytes. And I think RDS files are gzipped, or they can be. So this could be shrunk potentially. Okay. So the next thing is like, okay, how do we look at the outputs of this? So the first plot that I have, and this takes a second to load, is just the comparisons of the RMSE of the different model types. And you can see here that like our best performer is XG Boost, which is not surprising given it's able to incorporate everything, and it allows for nonlinear relationships and intercollinearities and all the fun stuff that is really hard to maintain in to take care of in a linear model.
Tree models are nice. Sure.
Nearest neighbor didn't do very well either. It's very similar to the linear models, and the MLP, which I think is the
neural net.
It's the neural net. Didn't do very well at all. But random forest, random forest, and XG Boost performed very well. And I think, now help me interpret this. The output of this, these RMSEs are huge compared to some of the other RMSEs that we had saw before. But this is in the sales price, right? In the sale price scale. So we're talking about an RMSE of like $25,000 on a house that could cost, you know,
hundreds of thousands
of dollars. Mm-hmm. So like on that scale, it kind of makes sense that we might have quite a high RMSE, like as a number. Does that ring true to both of you? Because that's how I justified the big numbers.
Yeah, I mean, I think so. So you were using the raw sales price, not the log, to predict?
Yes.
Okay. So yeah, I would expect you would get, because if you take the log of that, it's much
And
smaller.
That's another thing too, you know, I could have logged the sale price and maybe there might have been a better fit there as well. Although, given XGBoost's capabilities, would that have mattered?
It's hard to say. That's one you would just have to try, I think,
I think for the linear stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like that's the general guidance.
It was. So for the linear stuff, it was log 10.
Oh, so yeah, it was log there. Yeah.
For the other stuff, it wasn't. I don't think. Where's the recipe for XG? Yeah, I'm pretty sure I didn't log it because that came straight out of use this.
Yeah, I had a thing where I ran side by side, and in one I logged it, and in the other I didn't. Actually, not logging it ended up being a lot better. So, and I think it was because there were like just enough random way outliers that it just pulled it out and caused havoc if you tried to use log. So, yeah.
Yeah. So these next ones are like, okay, well, we think that XGBoost is performing the best. How do we actually pull that out and run the final fit? And so that's what this is trying to do. So you do this, you create this thing where it ranks the models, and you're pulling out the specific RMSE as your indicator, and all you do is arrange it, and then you pull out the best one by slicing the ranks and just pulling it out, and then pulling out the workflow ID. So you can say dummy boosted.
Boosting is the champ.
So what's good about this is that, you know, because this is pulling out the name of the best one, because when we the book types out the quotes in the in these calls here. Whereas now this is a variable that you can just use, so it doesn't matter what it's called, it can just pull it in. I forget where I saw that. Maybe it was in the book, or maybe it was in the notes. I think it might have been in the notes. Mm-hmm. But now you don't. You could just run this on any output pretty much now, as long as RMSE is the metric you want to use to evaluate the model, and it gives you the workflow ID and it pulls the best one out, and the best one is the this particular one. And then what you do is you run that, you run that last fit on the aim split,
mm-hmm.
and you get your final output model. And then you can look at the metrics of that. $26,000 RMSE with an R squared of 0.91. And then you can, the last thing I did was to just look at the fit itself. Let me find it. It's buried behind here. Was to just look at the fit and see like where did it perform well, where did it perform poorly. Appears to be some houses in the high end that really have high prices that the model didn't perform very well.
Kind of underpredicted. Yeah.
And it would be kind of interesting to dive into those and just kind of see. I just ran out of time, to be honest.
Oh, sure. No, understandable. But, you did a lot here. Yeah. It would be curious to see that one over on the sort of upper left too. I'd be curious to know what that one is.
Oh yeah, this one here. Yeah,
there's
for
probably
sure.
Something funky about that house. But I mean, it looks good. It's hugging the line pretty good for most of the range.
I'm not sure I would use this model to buy a house in Ames, Iowa.
You might end up like Zillow.
Yeah. I thought it was kind of useful to go through everything that we've done and put it all in one and
hands on thing.
I've been able to replicate precisely.
Very nice.
So I haven't used this hat thing function. I've used parameters and mm-hmm. just do parallel. So
where was that? That was in the XG boost?
What?
Where was that hard hat problem you had?
Yeah, let me share. I show you.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, I couldn't even get it to install, but that's kind of that was my own issue. I think that R tools. If I can just get that R tools on my system, I'm good.
Okay. This is the plot. Exactly the same. So boost 3 is lowest. Yeah. And the last plot is this. There it is. So it works. What I mentioned is what didn't work. Where is it? The neural. There it is. So you applied this function, which I did even change it again, because in the book it said set deals. Instead, you didn't put the set. But anyway, for me, it didn't work other way. So instead, because I missed some packages, and I have an old version of R, so I use just parameters instead of this function. I've used parameters, and that's it, nothing else, all the same. And do parallel. And I didn't even need these two packages.
Yeah, that might have just been me copying and pasting, and I deleted lines.
I put it here. No, I did it because I've tried loading later. I have some problems, so this is in my addition. So I didn't use it. The only package I use, neither of those. These two packages, that's it.
Yeah, I think over time they'll as this continues to develop, they'll get it to where you can just load kind of one thing and it'll take care of itself.
More
kind of like deep dplyr does today with dplyr, tidyr, and so on and so forth with the tidyverse package.
Yeah,
I imagine it'll get there pretty soon. But yeah, so I hope that was helpful, because it was helpful for me to just kind of go through and try and fit everything together. I don't know if the solution is to just run everything through XGBoost or what.
Honestly, so I can just speak from my own personal experience. We do predictive modeling, and you know, we've looked at a lot of other techniques, but XGBoost is kind of the workhorse, is what I've observed here. So yeah,
I need to read up on it, because it's like, why is it so good? Like, what does it do different that other models don't do that it seems to just work better?
Yeah, the general idea is just, yeah, the whole business of, well, you build a tree, then you focus on things that your tree was bad at predicting, then you focus on things that tree was bad. Yeah, so you just kind of refine it along the way. And I think also just, you know, it's over the years been developed. It's pretty good performance. Just, yeah, in general, just a really good tool. The other one I've been wanting to look at, I don't know if it's integrated with Tidy Models, is Cat Boost. And that's the one that the Russian Google built and released. So it's kind of like XGBoost, but it's supposed to be a lot better with like categorical data, and it's supposed to be faster to train and everything. So if you want like a quick turnaround time, so that's kind of on my to-do list to check that out.
Do you deal with a lot of categorical data, or?
Honestly, it depends on the project. Mostly not. So yeah, that's the thing. But we do have things. So like, not to get too deep into the woods or tell secrets, so we're doing predictions based on like medical and prescription data, so as you can imagine, there's a lot of different drugs, so that ends up being a lot of different, you know, potential features and variables, so that's kind of our big challenge, I would say.
Thousands of drugs, right?
Yeah, it's kind of a dimension thousand. It's kind of a dimension reduction challenge. Having all these, hundreds of thousands of drugs. And
well, because you have active ingredients and then you have different formulations of them, right?
Right. Well. And then you have, of course, it's rife for interaction effects and things like that. So, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's interesting. I'll say that. But, yeah.
Well, basically, what you did is to... this is something, so basically my question is, how did you, this I've tried making visualization, but how did you choose those type of models? Why?
Oh, these are from the book.
Okay.
So I... Again, I'm not the best statistician, so like I took those specific mm-hmm. models with the interaction factors and all that. Those are straight from the book.
Okay.
And in fact, a lot of these, the poly recipe and everything else is from the book.
You could also look and. You know, it's kind of a time thing though, right? Because you could do EDA and then say, oh, I think there's an interaction effect here, stuff like that. But yeah, sometimes you just kind of like, hey, let's look at everything. All right, here we go.
Yeah, no, because that's quite challenging, you know, that we've been talking about these things. So you have a data, and then you look at the data, and then you think about what you are going to do with this data, and what we are going to predict, what you know, you know? So you have, for example, sales plans. So it's numeric, can be like ordered somehow, if you divide them by class, you know, you might want to like, say from 0 to 250, 250 to 500, you can build up classes of sales.
You're talking about stratification? Because the stratification mm-hmm. is included in the initial split for sure. And it's stratified it was stratified, I think, by sales price. Yeah. So I tried to accommodate not getting like all super expensive houses in the training data and all super cheap
houses. Do a representative sample.
As far as like what the model ended up choosing, in some cases, I would say I don't really fully grasp that myself.
But basically, on that, so you based on your response variable and based on the type of data that you got, you decide for which type of models to use, no? Then you can even try certain different type of models, such as this one here, like neural network, KNN, support vector machines, and everything. Then to find at the end, XGBoost is the best one for this purpose.
I didn't try all those models. In fact, I cut out the SVM just to save time on the processing, because I wanted to be able to like run it and then like, and for you all to run it. That's why I pushed really hard to try and get it to you yesterday, or what was my yesterday. Mm-hmm. It's just probably your morning, Federica. But like I tried to get it to y'all yesterday so that you could run it, and I tried to keep it under an hour on my machine because I figured y'all could run it on yours and have a play, and you know,
it took quite long. I should have saved it somewhere. How long it took? Where is it?
Full results time should be there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
A little over an hour. Yeah.
Well, it's 8,000.
Or about an hour. Yeah, the lapse time.
It's like an hour and a half.
Yeah, the lapse time is a little under an hour though, right? Because 3,100.
I don't know. I didn't
130 minutes. So it's a little over an hour, a little over 2 hours for Federica.
And the grid didn't took any time. So just you said that take longer. No, for me a sec. Didn't need
the same. You ran it with grid as well.
Yeah, this control.
Huh. That's confusing.
No, I didn't. I didn't put it.
Didn't run it with grid. Just the grid definition. That little thing there. That doesn't actually run the grid search. That's just the definition. So if you changed it to control grid control and run it, it should take a lot longer.
Okay.
Should. It may not. I don't know.
That's for sure. And then here you use defaults.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so that's why. No, because you said you didn't use defaults. You used defaults.
And that's one of the reasons why I reduced the number of resamples, or the V, because I didn't want it to take forever. I'm sorry it took 2 hours on your machine. I tried to tone it down as much as I could, but still at the same time kind of have...
No, excellent. No, I'm happy that you managed to do that, because I
could that's cool.
Go through your code, but I didn't manage to do it myself. So my question, sorry if I keep interrupting, but my question is, you use stepped interrupt twice. Okay, the first time, because you know, you already use it, stepped interrupt here. And then you did it again. So
yeah, but it's a different recipe. That's the thing.
Yeah.
So here in this workflow set, you see basic, interact, and splines. Both interact and splines have the interaction effect in them, because spline inherits interaction. And then later when you do the poly, you make the nonlinear. I don't actually know what step poly does, to be honest. At this, like, I forget exactly what it does. So, but you do something, you pre-process that, and then you do the interaction effects between all of your parameters.
Okay. No, because I got confused, most probably because I've.
So that's why it's twice. Yeah.
Yeah, because you did it on the first recipe that you did it here.
But that one was very specific to living uh-huh. area versus building type.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And I think when we had done, I'm sorry, one of the things is I didn't spend very much time doing like summarizing the early. So we talked a bit ago about like, you could just run an XG boost on everything and like not do any exploratory analysis, but that's not the point of
right.
what they're trying to say. And that's kind of what I did here. I just went straight to the modeling. I didn't really do mm-hmm. the exploratory phase at all. And I didn't want to do that, but I just didn't have the time to really dig in. And
that makes
we
sense.
Had already kind of done some of that early on in the first few chapters.
Right.
So I didn't include that here, but you're absolutely right. Cause like, you know, why would you choose interaction effects with living area and building type? Without there's not a lot of understanding behind there why you would do that.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it's so sorry, Federica. It's a little bit of an overlook on my part.
No, that's interesting. That's okay.
I think it's good. I think yeah, because kind of your focus here was to look at the actual techniques of using the Tidy Models toolkit. So I think as far as that goes, it's a real good example of that. So yeah, I think, yeah, definitely if you wanted to go deeper into EDA, you can. But yeah, I think it's a good example of just sort of how to go through the whole step and set up all these, set up all this scaffolding.
But I totally agree with you, Federica. I think if you were doing this for real and this was your job, you would spend a lot more time understanding your data, making basic plots of your data, understanding whether or not the data is like, you know, normally distributed or not, relationships, which ones are nonlinear, which ones are linear, and so on and so forth.
Yeah, I agree.
I skipped over all that.
But because these data are already clean.
There's limitation of time, so
yeah,
it's understandable.
These data are okay, so you can use it straight away like this. If you...
The next thing I'm going to do is run an XG boost model on my data for work.
There you go.
See what the hell comes out the other Woo-hoo! Side.
Yeah. What is this clipboard file for?
I don't remember.
Clipboard equals false. I don't know either. Curious.
I'm going to look it up. Hold on. That was under recipe? Inside recipe?
That was in the XGBoost recipe.
Further arguments passed on to methods. I don't know. That came out of the use this. I'm not sure why.
Save files. So that's absolutely so basically it seems like straightforward to do somehow, because you know you use the workflow set, you put all the things inside your models, your recipes, your model, then option add. The parameters are quite challenging somehow when you need to pull them out. Then choosing between rays or grid, why you use rays instead of grid, which one is better. That was in the chapter at the end. But, you know, we are a step forward with tidy models. So. And I did this verbose. I took off this verbose too because sometimes it's a problem.
Use models.
Where is the, if I find the chapter, the applied modeling book, I'll show you.
So the clipboard false might be from use models. So let me, I'm going to post this in the Slack. It has a clipboard false. I think what it does is like you could literally run that code if with true, and then it would put it in your clipboard, and you could paste it to where you want to put it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's where that comes from. Why that carries over into recipe, I'm not entirely sure. But that's exactly like, that's actually the same function that I used to create most of the spec. And then what I did was I put the workflow into the rest of the workflows, so it would all run at once. But anyway, sorry to interrupt, Federica.
No.
I think that's what it comes from, but I'm not. When you look at the help for recipe, clipboard is not a parameter for recipe. It's also not a parameter for XGB train or XGBoost. So it's part of the dot dot dots, which is gets inherited to other calls, other functions further downstream.
So we're done.
I think
we did it, guys.
We need an emoji for the. Yeah, there we go. We'll do that one.
Cool.
But yeah,
made it to the end.
It's been a good time. Thank you so much for leading us, Federica. Really,
yeah, thanks, Federica, for
perseverance on that.
Wrangling us all.
we were very much. You're very much herding cats.
Total cat herding.
Yeah. So appreciate that. I've learned quite a bit. I've realized I need to learn a lot more as well.
It's always a side effect of these things. Yeah.
So anyway, but good times. Appreciate it. I'm sure I'll see you on the Slack, both y'all and ping me sometime if you need some help or whatever. I'm willing to help y'all out if I can.
Nice. Likewise. Just keep in touch.
Cheers. Yep.
Take care, everybody.
Take care.
Have a good weekend.
Bye.
Bye.